We've got some great questions today. Pat, let's get started. William writes, since Hollywood has framed exorcism as witchcraft, all my friends won't go to an exorcist. I have 2 times experienced the service of one, and it decreased my seizures and depression. How do I get others to believe?
You know, it's a funny thing. I don't know of anybody who's a professional exorcist. Do you?
I do not either.
I've never heard of such a title, nor is it one of the gifts of the Spirit. I believe that there can be exorcisms. I believe it's possible that somebody filled with the Holy Spirit can cast out demons. I've done it myself. I know. But in terms of somebody being a professional exorcist, how can I get somebody to believe in them? I just don't. I believe that Jesus Christ has power over demons. But professional exorcist, I don't know.
Because he doesn't say how this guy's casting it out. Is he using the name of Jesus?
By all means, you know, in the New Testament, there was a case of a Jewish exorcist, you remember? And he said, in the name of Jesus that Paul preaches, come out. You remember that?
Yeah.
And the demon said, I know Jesus and I know Paul, and who are you? And he jumped on this guy.
Jumped on him.
And they fled naked. All right, what's next?
All right, Kay writes, what exactly did Jesus mean by wavering in believing your prayers will be answered? Does it include very short periods of doubt when you are fighting hard to keep the faith?
Well, he says, you say to a mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, and do not doubt in your heart. Then you will have the thing that you say. There's got to be agreement with God. There has to be an agreement with God that what you're saying will happen. It doesn't mean somewhere along the line that you might not be assaulted with doubt. But it does mean while you're praying in the name of Jesus, you're believing that Jesus is real and he's going to do what you say. That's what he says. All right.
Okay. Karen writes, my parents, my son and firstborn and my children's father have all died and I never mourned. And even though I may have cried at some point of realization and reflection upon their deaths, I have never felt any real sense of loss. Is there something wrong with me? I do experience love, empathy, and sympathy for others. I hate to see suffering and will do all I possibly can to ease the suffering of others. I value your opinion.
I don't think anything's wrong with you. It's a little unusual, though, not to feel some grief. You mean you've had some serious losses. I dare say somewhere in your childhood, you were hurt very badly. Mm. Somebody abandoned you, somebody that you relied on turned against you. And somehow something inside of you turned off and said, I'm not going to get hurt again. You hear that, that's the big thing in literature and the movies. I'm never going to get hurt again. I'm in love and I'm not going to get hurt again. Mm-hmm. So, okay. That may have happened to you when you were a youngster. You might not even be aware of it. And so there's a wall in you that refuses to allow you, that part of you to open up. But I think you ought to ask the love of God. Tell you what, when I get emotional is when I think of God's love. I'm more than, you know, somebody dies, you're sad, you know, it really tears you up. But at the same time, it's the love of God that really breaks our the stony heart. The love of God and what He does for us and how much He loves us. All right.
Leonard writes, in one part of 1 Corinthians 13, Paul and the Spirit of God declare, love believes all things. I'm trying to be faithful, but not gullible. Could you please explain what you think Paul and the Holy Spirit mean by this?
Well, I think, look, there are people who go through life suspicion of everything. They suspect everything. They don't trust anybody. And Paul says people who love, they believe. They trust people. They are open-hearted, and they believe people. They're not suspicious of people all the time. I think that's what he's saying. It believes all things, loves all things. But it doesn't mean it's gullible. I mean, you see somebody, you know, with a shell game, you know, I've got a pea under 3 shells, and I'll give you, give me $5 and see if you can pick the right one. You know, I mean, there are con artists out there. We're not supposed to be gullible. We're not supposed to be taken in by people. And it's not a lack of love to the Bible says, test of the spirits, you know, see if they're of God. So we're told to test the spirits.
Love believes the best.
Always looking for the good if he possibly can find it. But nevertheless, we'd be crazy to be gullible fools and let con artists take us or the devil to seduce us. All right, what else?
Nikki says, Pat, I live with my boyfriend and we have two children. We're going through a tough time in every way and want to get right with God, but are not married. Can we get saved and go to heaven without getting married?
Why do you ask me a question like that? Why in the world would you get married? I mean, what's a license going to cost you, $20, $25? Go get a wedding license. Go to the Justice of the Peace if you want to. If you want to get a preacher, you can find a preacher someplace.
Well, for the kids' sake as well. You know, they've got two children.
Yeah, I can't just boyfriend. We get so many questions about people who are living together without being married, and they're having children. You want your children to have rights of inheritance. There's so many legal things having to do with marriage. I know we've got what we call a marriage penalty built into the tax code, so it's a little more expensive, but that shouldn't be a consideration. But will you go to heaven without tying the knot? I suppose, I don't know your state of mind. If you've accepted Jesus Christ, He will take you to heaven. But at the same time, you're going to be miserable on earth unless you get this thing right. Mm. Take your boyfriend and walk down to the courthouse or the clerk of the court, get a license and find a justice of the peace or a preacher and get married. It's not that hard.
Amen.
Whew. Okay.
You solved that.
I've solved it.